So welcome everyone to this webinar dedicated to the introduction of WebRatio 8 mobile platform. I'm Lucio Bordonato from WebRatio, and in the next 2 hours we will see the new features of WebRatio 8 mobile platform. This will be the agenda of the webinar. So we will start introducing why you should consider developing mobile apps nowadays, and what are the possible approaches to the mobile app development. Then we will see how WebRatio mobile platform is qualified as a mobile application development tool, and the generated mobile app characteristics for WebRatio generated apps. We will test the generated mobile application, and later we will also see a live overview of WebRatio mobile platform. Then at the end of the webinar, I will give you some time for question and answer. So if you got questions during the webinar, please write into the chat so that at the end of the webinar, I will answer to all of your questions. Okay, so let's start from the mobile. In 2014, the so-called mobile year, stating to what Gartner says in a report, in 2014 the number of mobile users really became very high, till it outnumbered the number of desktop users. And the mobile market of mobile application is dominated, literally dominated, by Android OS based devices, when for the remaining part of the market there is the iOS based devices that holds another important share of the market. Mobile in 2014 became one of the top three IT priorities for business. So basically everyone is concerned and dedicated to the mobile app development. And soon, always to what related to what the Gartner report says, the mobile app development project will soon outnumber the native PC projects by 4 times. This is just a measure of how the mobile app development project will be important in the next years. And in the next years, more than a half of all the mobile application will be soon created by business analysts using codeless tools. So basically the direction in which we are going as mobile development for the mobile application is that the number of tools, number of codeless tools will always rise. Okay? This chart with numbers taken from comscore.com showed you that in 2014 we have the most important point for the number of global users related to mobile and desktop platform. You see that in 2014 the number of global users in millions for mobile application was higher than the number of users for the desktop application. The difference between these two numbers will rise in the next years, and as you can see, in 2015 the difference will be very, very high. This other chart coming from IDC shows you the market share for the mobile applications, okay, related to the mobile operating systems. As you can see, the biggest share of the market is held by Android, okay, which is between the 80 and the 90% of the market share. The remaining piece of shares in this market are represented by iOS, then Windows Phone, and BlackBerry, and others. What does it mean? It means that if you are developing mobile apps, you are very concentrated on Android and iOS market shares. And as you can see here in the chart, we put the WebRatio sign, the WebRatio logo, near to Android and iOS, just to say that our tool, our mobile WebRatio 8 mobile platform, will be able to develop and build mobile application for Android and iOS. Coming to what are the strategies, the development strategies for mobile applications, there are three ways, okay, three standard ways to develop mobile application. You can have native mobile application. Native mobile application and developing a native mobile application means that for every platform you have a different coding language, okay? So, for example, considering Android, you will start developing the application using Java code. Instead, for iOS operating system, you will develop your mobile application in Objective-C, and so on. For example, if you consider Windows Phone as an operating system, you will have to develop the mobile application in C#. Okay? Developing a native mobile application means that you have to learn different languages, okay, according to the platform that you want to target. And this means to lose a certain amount of time in learning the new languages and how the new platform and how the different platform work. Okay. Also, from an effort of development, developing a mobile app as native, it means that you have to create different apps for different platforms. Okay, so you will have to, if you want to target Android, iOS, and Windows Phone, you have to develop three different apps, one for each operating system. Another kind of approach, another development strategies for mobile application is web. Okay, you can create mobile web applications. Okay, the mobile web applications are standard web applications that are able to adapt the content and the structure of the application to the device, okay, that is being used. Web apps run on every platform, okay? So the difference with the native one is that they work on a browser, okay? So actually you just have to know the standard languages for programming for the web, okay, so HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. This means that you develop the application once, okay, so you create only one web application, and then every operating system using the browser is able to show and view the web application. In between the native development strategy and the web development strategies, there is the hybrid one, which is the one targeted by WebRatio, as you can also see by the WebRatio logo. Here the strategy is slightly different from the other two. It's like a merge between the other two. When you develop an hybrid mobile application, your mobile application will be used by all of the platforms that you want to target. Okay, in WebRatio, case, we are targeting Android and iOS at the moment. In this case, the application is not run natively or into a browser, but it's run into a native wrapper, okay, which is a set of, like, let me say, an environment, okay, a native environment inside which you run your application in a browser engine or directly using the native UI. Okay, this means that you have both the container, the native container, so you can use the native tools of your phone like the accelerometer, the photo camera and so on, but you can also develop your web application, your mobile application using standard languages that are also used in the web. Okay, so HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So the WebRatio choice is to create mobile application using the hybrid development strategy. Okay, this allows to make an abstraction from the mobile platform, so you can target whatever platform you want to target. For WebRatio, I repeat, it's only Android and iOS at the moment. And another advantage is that the code is written using standard programming languages. Okay, so HTML, CSS, and JavaScript are easier to learn and are mostly known than Java, Objective-C, C#, and so on. So the code is standard and it's easy to generate. So what is the solution of WebRatio tool? WebRatio mobile application development platform, which is WebRatio 8 mobile platform, is a model-driven application, okay, so a model-driven tool to develop your application visually programming and not writing any line of code. Okay, so this means that basically, like for those who already know the old versions of WebRatio, so the web-related versions, we will keep that approach. To develop mobile application, you will visually model the requirements and the logic of your application. Mobile application modeled with WebRatio 8 mobile platform will be based on IFML modeling language. Okay, so they will be based on IFML, the standard that was already introduced in WebRatio 7.2. The smart code generation is an important thing. Okay, so starting from the model, starting from what is visually designed inside the tool, the engine behind WebRatio generates automatically the code, creating cross-platform mobile application and letting you use standard Java backend services. Okay, we will see something in the live demo. So the apps that you develop with WebRatio are ready for the production either on premises or directly into the WebRatio cloud. Okay, so what are the underlying technologies of WebRatio, WebRatio 8 mobile platform? Here you see a lot of logos. These are all the technologies used by WebRatio in the process of generating the smart generation of the code, okay, the one that we see in here. Okay, you see Ionic, which is used to, it's an optimized tool for developing hybrid applications. We used Cordova, Apache Cordova, to interact with the device API, okay, always for hybrid applications. JayData is a data access library, okay, in order to manipulate the JavaScript data. SQLite instead is the SQL database engine that was adopted. AngularJS was used to manage quickly the HTML and JavaScript code, while the standard technology are HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript. So all of the code that WebRatio generates when you develop your own mobile application is made of HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript. And these are all of the technologies used during this process. So, as a result, what is the architecture of the mobile app, okay, of any mobile app that you develop with WebRatio? Every app is surrounded by the PhoneGap application container, okay, that you can also see here. Inside this container, there are the app, okay, which is the one generated by WebRatio, made of HTML code, CSS, JavaScript, and graphical resources. The app is run into the HTML rendering engine, okay, which is practically speaking the web view of your operating system. And the HTML rendering engine communicates with the PhoneGap plugins, okay, in order to let you use directly some features of your device, okay, like the accelerometer, geolocation media network, and so on. Then the operating system APIs are accessed, so you have the full access to the mobile operating system, okay? So all of this is managed by PhoneGap, which is Apache Cordova, and this is the app, okay, the core app generated by WebRatio. So starting from this architecture that we will see in work later on, in WebRatio, WebRatio 8 mobile platform will be possible also to test directly your mobile application, okay? Like it was happening for the web applications, also for mobile application you will have the possibility of generating your prototypes very quickly, okay, and see immediately the changes that you do in the model. So you change something in the model, you generate the app, and you are able to see in a few seconds the changes introduced by that change on the model, okay? You can emulate the mobile application on your computer, so while you are developing, or directly on mobile devices, okay? So you have two possibilities: to test and emulate the mobile application on mobile devices, we created and we submitted into the Play Store and Apple Store the WebRatio Mobile Developer app, okay? That you see a screenshot here. This is an app that lets you try, that you try the mobile applications directly on your phone, okay, without building anything. I think you also received the links for the WebRatio mobile developer app into the invitation mail for the webinar. And now let's see how does it work, the connection between the client side of the mobile application and the server side. The client side of the mobile application can communicate with the server side in all the possibilities. You can mix all of the possibilities here. So you can have a client-side WebRatio generated mobile app, okay, which is the first situation here, that communicates using the APIs with the server side made already in WebRatio. So you have the client side made in WebRatio, which is the mobile app, and the server side, which is also made in WebRatio, that represents the backend. Okay, so this is the first possibility that you have for mobile app development. Then you have the first, let me say, hybrid situation in which the client side is a WebRatio generated mobile app, okay, that communicates with a backend made externally from WebRatio. This is a generic backend made outside of WebRatio. And finally, you can also create only the backend of the web application in WebRatio and then use the client side made outside of WebRatio. Okay? So these are the possibilities that we guarantee using that automatic code generation. Okay? So the mobile app that you create with the WebRatio are open. Okay, they can communicate with a backend made in WebRatio, but also with an external backend. And the same, and the same thing is also true for the client side. So you can have a client side made in WebRatio that communicates with an external backend, but you can also have an external client side that calls a backend made in WebRatio. How to make the backend for mobile application will be part of the live demo, since we will see that WebRatio 8 mobile platform introduces another type of project, okay, which is the data service project, okay, that we will go through during the live demo. Okay, so now finally it's time to start our WebRatio 8 mobile platform live session, okay? So what we will do in the next hour and a half? We will start modeling a mobile application that works completely offline, okay? So no backend, no logic, just an application for the Hello World sample, okay? A very simple web application, an easy to do and easy to run application. I will use the Hello World example to show you how to generate, run and test, okay, the mobile application. Then we will, let me say, increase the level of our mobile application, introducing data management, screen navigation, login and screen protection, backend services, and data synchronization. Finally, I will also show you how to build a mobile application. Okay? So, let's start opening WebRatio. This is WebRatio mobile platform. Okay? You see that the interface, for those who already know WebRatio from the previous edition, is always the same, okay? The first thing that you see that is changing is the type of projects that you can develop from this platform, okay? So from here, you can create mobile projects, which are basically mobile application, or data service projects, okay? Data service project has I said a few minutes ago, are the backend projects that we will use for our web for our mobile applications. Okay, so let's start creating our Hello World mobile application, file, new mobile project. Okay, so let's call this one Hello World. Okay, by clicking on finish, the mobile application is created. Okay, and you see the inner structure of the application. Okay, you also see the structure of the mobile project. Okay, each mobile project is made of these three views, okay, which are the domain model view, the app view, and the action definitions view. The domain model view is the view in which we will define, okay, the data structure used by the mobile application. Here the notation used for the domain model is the UML class diagram, okay? So we will put here all of the entities and relationships and attributes required by our mobile application. The app view is the view in which we will build all of the IFML model for the mobile application. So screens, components, navigation flows, and events and whatever. Okay, so everything that is made with IFML elements will be put inside here. Finally, the action definition view is the place where you define the backend, let me say backend, but it can also be client-sided backend logic, okay? That will be executed by the web application, the mobile application. I've seen a question coming. As I said previously, all of the questions will be answered at the end of the webinar. So I ask you to wait till the end in order to get all of your questions answered. Okay? Okay, so our Hello World mobile application will be very easy. We will not do anything inside the domain model view. Okay, we do not add anything. As you can see, there are two entities and one relationship which is already there. The reason is that we will use these two entities later for managing the user profiles. Okay, we will only have to work inside the app view. Okay, so we will start creating new IFML model from here. Let's add a screen, okay, to our app view. The first screen that we add can be the home, okay, of the mobile application. And automatically, since this is the first screen that we add to the app view, it will be identified as the home screen. So the starting point for the interaction on our mobile application. Okay, let's put inside this home page a welcome message for the user. Okay, so I go inside the view component section of the toolbar and I pick the message component. Okay, this is the welcome message. Let's put a text here, so hello world. Oh, let's write like this. This is my first WebRatio mobile app. Okay, now the model for the Hello World is completed. Okay, let's see what happens if you want to test this very simple mobile application. Okay, in order to generate the code and to immediately run the mobile application on your computer, you have to use the generate and run command, okay, which is available directly from the toolbar. If you click here, you can see the process starting in the bottom right of the WebRatio interface. And as soon as the generation process is completed, you will see the console of the mobile emulator, which starts to log information, and you will see your default browser, which, pay attention, must be Chrome, okay, Google Chrome, running the so-called dashboard for the app, okay? So as soon as you click the generate and run button, it starts generating. At the end of the generation, you have this page, okay, which is the dashboard page for the mobile application, in which you have the two possibilities that I was telling you previously, okay? So you can run the app on your PC, you can test the app on your PC using the emulator link that you have here, or you can test the mobile application on your device, okay, scanning this QR code from the WebRatio mobile developer app. So you open, you download, first of all, of course, from the store, okay, from the Google Play Store or from the Apple Store, the WebRatio mobile developer app, okay. You install it on your device. Then from the WebRatio mobile developer app, you have a button that it's also shown here in the slide. You have the scan QR code button, okay, that you use to scan this QR code, and automatically the application starts running on your device, okay? Otherwise, you can just open the WebRatio mobile developer app and type the address of your mobile application. Okay, now for some structural reason, I cannot show you from this webinar the application running on the device, but you can do it while I'm speaking to you for the webinar. I will use always the PC emulator, okay? So basically you just click on that button and you will see Ripple, the emulator that we use, loading the web, loading the web page containing the emulator and, of course, the mobile application, okay? So this screen that you see here at the center of the screen, okay, of my browser, is the welcome screen that we modeled previously in WebRatio, okay? So this is the welcome message with the text, okay? Hello world, this is my first WebRatio mobile app, okay? From this emulator, you can customize a set of properties if your app has specific needs, like testing the orientation of the device, changing the size of the screen. So, for example, I can just reload everything for the iPhone 5 or iPhone 3 or 4, okay? You can check other information on the status of the application, like the size of the screen, the user agent, the CSS pixels, and so on, okay? So you have on the left this kind of generic information. On the right you have other settings, like device and network settings, location settings, and so on, okay? So basically you have everything that you need in order to test your mobile application, okay? Good. So let's move to a more complex example of mobile application, introducing a little bit of more logic into the mobile project, okay? So I will close this Hello World project and I will create a new mobile project. Okay, let's call it Companies Manager App, okay? And then let's click on Finish. So the structure of the project is the same that you already seen previously. Maybe what you will notice working on apps is that the console tab view that you have here keeps growing and keeps logging information. Don't worry about it, even if you see some errors here. These are not blocking errors, so don't worry about that. You just run your application using the generator run, and you can test it directly on your device or on your emulator. Okay? So let's start introducing a little bit of logic and a little bit of data structure in our Companies Manager app. Okay? I will create just one entity, okay, which is the company entity. I use the class concept, okay? Entity is the concept for those who came from the web experience with WebRatio. I create a new class, which is the company class, okay? And then you can start adding other attributes to this entity. You can do it manually, right-clicking on the class, or you can just choose the edit class command, okay, which shows a better organized structure for adding the attributes. Okay, so let's put the address of the company, which is a string. Let's put the country, okay, which is another type string. The VAT code, the flag whether to check if the company is a partner or not, and finally the logo of the company, which is a blob type of file with content type image. Okay, so this will be, and of course I was forgetting about the name of the company. Okay, so this is the structure that we will use to manage our companies in our mobile application. Okay, and the first thing that I want to do is to show in the home page of my mobile application, okay, a list of companies. Okay, you see that I put here the list view components into the screen. Then let's set some data binding properties. I choose the company class, and into the list I want to show the name, the country, and the logo. Let me organize a little bit the informations like this. First the logo, then the name, and then the country. Okay, then I order everything by name. Okay, and from this point I'm creating a mobile application with just one screen, which is the home screen, and the list of all the companies available in my domain model. Okay, pay attention that I have no connection to any kind of database, okay? So all of the informations that I'm managing right now are stored on the client, so they are client-sided, okay? There is no connection to the backend or to the remote service, okay? So I just created this class with all of these properties and this screen with the list. I click the generate and run button, and I wait for the mobile app to be generated, okay? Okay. So you will see that the app dashboard is now loaded with the new app, okay? So we no longer have the Hello World mobile application, but we have the Companies Manager app. And here we have the same options that we had previously. So we can run the app into the emulator, or we can run it into the device. So let's open the emulator. And as soon as Ripple starts, you will see the app loading and the list of companies. Okay? All of these companies that you see here are fake data, okay, generated automatically by WebRatio in order to let you try the features of your mobile app. Okay? So here you see the logo on the left, sorry. You see the name of the company and the country, okay, of the company. This is the list of companies that we created, that we modeled into WebRatio. Okay, let's now make a little bit of changes to the model of the mobile app, adding a little bit of navigation. Okay, so right now we only have one screen, which is the home screen, okay, with the list of companies. Let's add on the mobile project another screen that shows the company details, okay? So this will be a new screen in which I will see all of the details related to one particular company, okay? So let's give to the component, to the detail component, the same name of the screen. Let's set also here the data binding, choosing the company class and all of the attributes except, of course, the primary key. Okay, now, one thing that we have to add in order to move from the screen with the list of companies to the details is to add the selection event, okay? So we want that the user select one of the companies and goes to the details, okay? This can be done automatically drawing a normal navigation flow between the list and the detail, okay? You see that automatically the type of event that is created is a select event, okay? So we can rename this one, for example, detail, okay? This is the details event of type selection. As was already happening on the web project and web apps, also on mobile apps, you have the feature, on mobile project, you have the feature of automatic binding, okay, when the source and target entity are the same. So here we move from a list of company to a detail of company, okay? So the primary key will be the same, okay? So WebRatio is able to automatically infer the binding between the two components, okay? This is enough to generate, once again, the mobile application. While it's generating, you will see this page empty, okay? And once that the generation process is completed, you will see the new timestamp of the operation and the possibility of running the emulator. If you already open it, like we did, the emulator, okay, on your mobile application, you can just refresh the page and you will see the list of companies with the new events, okay, with the new selection event that you have on the right. So if I tap here, I will see the new screen, which is the company detail screen, okay, showing all of the details for this company. So the company name, company address, the country, the VAT, and the detail about the partner, and finally the logo, okay? Right now the problem is that the only problem that we still have and that we will solve later in our demonstration is that we are not able to go back directly from this screen to the previous one. So for the moment, okay, for a few minutes, let's use the back button of the browser, okay? So I'm navigating the app in this way, okay? Good. Okay, now I want to introduce a little bit of data management, okay? So not only showing data, but also giving the possibility to the user to create new components, to delete components, okay? And to, let's say, manage, okay, all of the data that is being used by this mobile application, okay? So, always remember that we are not working with a real database and with real backend for now, okay? So, for a few minutes we will still work with fake data generated by WebRatio, okay? Then we will add all of the backend control. Perfect. So, what do we need in order to create new components? First of all, we need to have, okay, we need to have a new screen that I create here, and I can call add company, okay? Or better, let's call it company data, okay? Perfect. The screen will be available from the home screen of my mobile application, okay? So let me add here a view component of type message, okay? Let's call it welcome. And let's put inside here just a welcome message for the user, okay? So, welcome to Companies Manager app, okay? Just to have a little bit of detail and information on the home screen. Now, what happens to the home screen? I can change the view and the layout of any screen working from the layout view, okay? So you just pick the screen from the model, you open the layout view, and then you are able to change, for example, the order of view components inside the screen. So I can put the welcome message above the list of companies, okay? This helps to keep the information organized in a better way. Also, from the welcome screen, okay, I will add a navigation flow with another select event that goes to the company data screen, okay? This is, let's say, the add company select event, okay? Let's save and generate to see the new updates of our mobile project. Okay, so let's just reload the page. Okay, so this is the welcome message. Welcome to Companies Manager app. Here we have the old list of companies that we can use to see the details. And here we have the add company button, okay, that we can click and go to this empty page, which is our company data screen, okay? Let's add inside this screen a form component, okay, that we can call like the screen, so company data. This form component will have all of the properties required to create a new company object, okay? So let me use the edit form option and let me create a new field. The first one, it will be the name of the company of type string. Then let me create the address field, okay, the country field, the VAT field, the partner field, which is a Boolean, okay, and the logo field, which is a blob of type image, okay? Perfect. Now, let's save and generate once again in order to see the structure of this page with a form component. Okay, so let's reload the page of our repo emulator. Okay, if I use the add company button, I see this new screen in which I can type my company detail, okay, with the address. Okay, all of the required information, of course, I cannot save them. The partner, which was a Boolean type, is rendered in this way, okay? So this is false and this is the true value. And the logo, which was an image, a blob of image type, has this icon, okay? Once you click here, you have these two options, capture or gallery, okay? Of course, here on the emulator, it makes no sense to open the gallery or to capture, okay? On the real device, you will open the camera or the gallery of your device, okay? If I click capture here, it opens this kind of emulator for the camera. I can select a file from my file system just to emulate the behavior of the picture, or otherwise I can browse the gallery. And once again, I have the same screen, okay? This is done on the emulator. Of course, on the real device, you will see the standard camera or the gallery of your device, okay? Now, what we need to do is to make this form work, okay? Adding the logic, okay? Let me say the actions required in order to write the details of the company, write the data of the company into our company class. Okay, so we start storing the details of the companies inside our storage, okay, which is the client-sided database of the mobile application, okay? So what we need to do here? We need to create a new action definition, okay? That will be our save company action definition, okay? You create the action definition, you double click, and you see this new canvas, okay? In which you can model the logic of your action definition. Okay, we need to write what comes from the form, okay? So we will use the create operation. We have to set the binding, which is the company class, okay? You see that automatically it gets the name of the class that you choose, and then let's add all of the flows, okay, so the success flow from the input to the create and from the create to the success port, and the error flow from the create to the error port. Okay, let me just organize a little bit the model. Okay, now we need to receive data coming from the form, okay, and pass this data to the create in order to be written on the data structure. You can use the input port wizard, okay, on the input port. So you select the input port, you right-click here, and you choose the input port wizard. Okay? You have to choose the outgoing flows from this component, and all of the informations required by the create, okay, which are basically all of the fields, more or less, okay, it depends. This time they are mapped one-on-one, so we will have one attribute for each field, okay? Then you click on finish, and automatically it creates all of the input port parameters, okay, which are required by the input port, and also it automatically binds everything to the create, okay? Finally, let's add a little bit of feedback for the user. So I add the feedback message for the success port, which is the OK message that says as value operation completed. And as feedback for the error, we add the error message, okay? That says something like something went wrong, okay? Perfect. Now, once we have the action definitions here, we can go back to the app view and we can easily add the action here, okay? So you just take the action and you put it here into the canvas of the app view. We have to pick from the action definition list the only one that we have, which is the save company action definition, okay? And we have to connect the form component to the action definition, okay? Sorry, to the action, okay? We have already seen how to connect two different components using a navigation flow. This time it's different because the form, in order to be processed and in order to be executed correctly, it requires the submit type of event, okay, which is different from the selection type. For this reason, on the left-sided toolbar, you also have the option to add the submit event, okay? So you can pick the submit event and add it to the company data. Let's call it save, okay? Then I add the navigation flow from the save submit event to the save company action, okay? Now, if the operation is executed, okay, correctly, I will see a new screen, which is the feedback message screen, okay, that is a screen with only one message component, okay? The message that I will see here depends on the execution of the action, okay? So I basically add two navigation flows starting from the success and error ports that I have here, and I bind the OK message and the error message, okay? Perfect. One thing that is still missing in our model is the binding between the form and the action, okay? If we open the save navigation flow, you will see that the action is waiting for all of the attributes, okay, to be filled, okay, with data coming from the form. So we just use the guest binding button, okay, in order to map and to bind everything correctly, okay? Then we can save and generate the mobile application. Okay, here we have a problem with the values. Okay, maybe they are related to port definition values, so let's do like this. I just put the message directly here, so this is operation completed. Okay, and this is the something went wrong message. Okay, let's see if now we are able to generate. Okay, so once that the generation is completed, we refresh the emulator page, and from the home screen we are able to use the add company button. Let's add our WebRatio company. Okay. Perfect. And let's click on, the save button. Okay. The operation is completed successfully. As I said previously, we are not yet able, we will do it at the end of the live tutorial, of the live of the webinar, we are not able to go back in navigation of the pages, so let's use the back button of the browser. And from the main page, the last object of the list will be our new company, our WebRatio company. Okay? I'm able to see the details, so I can click here and I will see all of the details of my company. Okay, so we are doing a little bit of data management. We are writing into the client-sided storage, okay, and we have created a new company. Now let's add another feature to our mobile app. Let's add the possibility for the user to delete an existing company. Okay, so let me just organize a little bit the model so that there are no overlapping connections. I move the company details up here. Okay, and what I want to do now is that I want to create another action definition, this time to delete, okay, an existing company. So let me go back to the action definition view and let me create a new action definition, okay, that I call delete company. Okay. Inside the canvas, the core of this action definition, I'll put only a delete operation. Okay, this delete operation works on the company class. Okay, and let's put once again all of the required flows. This is an error flow. Perfect. Like we did previously for the same company action definition, we require the parameters. Okay, here the only parameter that we need, it will be the key of the object we want to delete. Okay, so it's automatically added. Let me rename it. Okay, so I rename it company key. It is automatically bind to the delete operation. And let's go back to the app view in order to add the new action. Okay, so this was very easy to realize. I put here the delete company action, which is called directly from the list of companies. And once again, this is another type of selection event. Okay, so I can directly drive and can directly write, sorry, a navigation flow into the model. Okay, this will be the delete selection event. This flow will carry on the OID of the company to the company key parameter of the delete company action. Okay. Now I can use once again the same page that I used previously for the feedback message. Okay. And I can add easily from here a navigation flow if something goes wrong. So I can put here the same message, something went wrong. Sorry. Otherwise, we will have the success flow that brings the operation completed message. Okay. So these are the two possibilities as feedback messages for our actions. Okay. Good. So let's see if everything works. Let's save and generate the mobile project. Okay. Let's refresh once again the repo emulator page. Okay, and what we see here is that since we have two navigation flows with the same type of event starting from the very same component, in the generated app we will see for each member of the list, okay, two different buttons, details and delete. Of course, what happened? Our WebRatio company, since we generated once again from scratch, was deleted from the client storage. Okay, so we have to create it once again from scratch. Okay, let's see if the delete button works. So I just click here. You see operation completed. I deleted the first one, so company one. If I go back, you see that company one is no longer available into the list. Okay, so it's very, very easy to implement and realize data management in WebRatio mobile platform. Okay, always remember that what you have seen till now, it's only related to the client storage. Okay, well, now it's time to introduce a little bit of remote management and service management. Okay, we will start adding the resource protection mechanism. So we will see, we will literally block, okay, the interaction of the user, adding some protection to the pieces of model that we have created. Okay, this means that we will introduce on the other end a login mechanism. Okay, so we will let the user authenticate into our mobile application. Okay, let's see how to do this. And let's do it first on the client side. Okay, so I will only create the client piece of model required to manage the authentication mechanism. Okay, okay, so let's do it. I have to create here in my canvas a new screen. Okay, I will put it here. Okay, let's call this screen login. Okay, this will be the page, the first page that the non-authenticated user will see before before taking a look to the main content of the app. Okay, all of the screens that we use to login must be flagged as login. Okay, this is a flag that you can see into the properties view of the screen. Okay, so the login screen will be not only login as name but also as property, and you will see visual feedback here in the upper left corner of the screen. Good. Now the login mechanism, it will be the standard one, so the one done using the username and password authentication. So I need here a form component, okay? A form component with two fields. So the first one, I right click and I choose the add field comment. The first one, it will be the username. The second one, it will be the password, okay? The password can be of password type, which is a particular string type that hides the characters, okay? Once I have the login page, I will wait for the user to provide the username and password. Once I have the username and password, I will start the login mechanism, okay? So basically there will be an action definition, okay, that will explicitly do the login, okay? So let's create a new action definition and let's call it login, okay? The content of this action definition will be just the login operation, okay? The login operation is a particular component, sorry, a particular operation that verifies the identity of the user and proceeds with the login. Okay, let's add, as we usually do, all of the flows. So let's create all of the required connections. And finally, let's provide from the input port all of the required parameters, which are the username and password. Perfect. Now, I have the login operation, I have the login action, I can go back to the app view, and I can put here my login action, okay? This login action is activated. Remember, this is a form, so we need a submit event, okay, which is called login, and this form will have the navigation flow leading to the login action. If the login is successful, I redirect the user to the home page of the mobile application. Otherwise, I go back to the login page, okay? I do something very easy. If everything is right, I go on with the navigation. If the validation of the credentials is not successful, I go back to the login page. Of course, at the moment, it will not really work. Since we don't have users, we don't have registered users, we don't have a backend that checks the credentials for the user, and we don't have the connection between the client side of the mobile app, which is this mobile project, and the backend of the mobile application. So I will just save and generate just to show you the login screen, how does it look, okay, at this point. So let me just refresh the emulator page. And What we see here is that the login page, which was the first one that we were expecting to see, it's not shown. Okay, what is the reason? The reason is that since we have no authentication mechanism to check, we have no backend connected, the user is automatically authenticated, so the login is it's like bypassed, okay, and we are directly thrown into the home screen of the web, of the mobile application. So what we have to do is to protect the resources of the mobile application. So basically I select everything, so all of the screens and all of the actions, I right click on one of them and I choose the command surround with screen set. Okay? The screen set is a container of objects that I will rename protected resources. Okay? This container by itself does nothing but has the property protected from the properties view, which sets the role for the authenticated user. So now you see that we also have a visual feedback of the key icon put on the top left of the screen set object. This means that from now on, only authenticated user will be able to access the home page. Okay? If now I save and generate, you will see excuse me, you will see that after the generation, let's restart once again. After the generation, only the logged in users will be able to see the web application. Okay? The mobile application, sorry. You see that now we have the login form showing the username and the password fields with the login button. Okay? Whatever I type here, if I press the login button, nothing happens. Okay? The reason is that there is no backend to verify the user credentials. Okay? So at this point, the client side of the app stops, okay? We have to introduce the backend of our mobile application. For this, this purpose, we create a new data service project. The data service project that we will call like companies manager backend. The data service project will be the remote controller, let me say, the remote storage for all of the data and all the validation of our mobile app. Okay? You see that each data service project has this structure, which is made of a domain model, service views and action definitions. Inside the domain model, we will define the data structure of the remote service. Okay? Before going on with the data service project, we need to have a database in which we can store the user credentials and later on the company data. Okay, so let me create a new database in MySQL. Okay, I create the database locally. Okay, so companies manager DB. Okay, Once this schema is created, I can go back to my data service project and I can create a database object, okay, which would be the Companies Manager DB node, okay, and connect to the real database. So this is a MySQL database that I can reach using this connection path. Okay, I have to provide here the username and the password to log in into the database. Let's check the connection using the refresh command. Okay, so the database is connected. Now we can synchronize the entities, okay, that we have in our domain model, the classes, okay? So you right-click, you choose the synchronize command, and you will see that WebRatio asks to export to the database the three classes and all of the association that exist, okay? So we export everything, we just execute all of the SQL statements, and we are able to map the three classes on the database. Now, what we have to do in order to let one application, which is the mobile application, communicate with the backend and check and validate the user, is first of all to have at least one user registered into the database, okay? So let me create a new user. I put admin as username and password. Okay, so first of all we need a user. Second thing, we need to configure the user service. User services are the services that we want to give to the users of the mobile app, okay? So if you right-click here and you choose Configure Services, you have this free possibility for the user class. You can let user register, login, and update, okay? We will only test, I will only show you the login process, okay? But we enable everything. Okay, we check all of the properties and we press the OK button. At this point you can save your data service project and you can generate and run your data service project, okay? The data service project must run on a Tomcat, which is configured for secure connection, okay? So we will use HTTPS as protocol. I've already done it. I don't want to show you this into the webinar, since it's just a matter of configuring the Tomcat. Okay. So first of all, we start the backend project and we run the backend app, okay? By default, it's opening the HTTP, using HTTP, so we just browse to localhost 8443. The name was Companies Manager Backend, if I'm not wrong. Okay, you have to do the first access every day that you work on your mobile application. I have to confirm that I know the source of this, I trust, let me say, these certificates. So this is what we will see. We see the user services, okay? This is the REST Web Service Management page. We enabled for the user services the update, register, and login services, okay? Now, what we have to do is to go back to the mobile app, to the mobile project, the company's manager app, and move to the project view, okay? Into the project view, we have to put the backend-based URL of our data service project, okay? It will be this one, okay? So everything except the name of page that we are browsing. So it will be localhost HTTPS, okay, localhost 8443, companies manager backend, okay? Perfect. Then we move to the domain model. Since we need to check if there is something to synchronize between the client side and the data service, so the backend side, of the project, okay? So you run the synchronize command, you choose the data service project, that is this one. If you click on next, you see that we have to synchronize the user services, okay? Which are the changes that we made on the backend of the web, of the application. We have to import everything into the domain model. Let's click on finish. You will see that the app user class now has some new attributes like remote ID, secret key, and email. Okay? Perfect. Now, once that data service project is up and running on a secure protocol, and once that the mobile project is linked together with the backend data service project, you can save everything, check the model correctness, okay? So we have to pass from the login form the password and the username to the action, okay? And now we can save everything and generate and run also the mobile application. Okay? And let's see what happens. Okay, so basically just reload the repo emulator page. Let me just reopen everything from scratch in order to have for sure the the latest version. So, okay, I opened the emulator and now I'm able to log in into the remote database. Okay, so I put here admin, which were the credential for the user, and I press the login button. Okay, you see that there was the loading icon. Now I'm logged into the backend of the mobile application and I'm able to browse the contents. Okay, if for example I go back to the login page and I put something wrong, like admin as username, you see that I have feedback, invalid username or password. Okay, so it's working. We have the remote side, the backend side check, okay, on the user credentials. Now, once that we have the login, we can concentrate on synchronizing not only the user credentials, so not only verifying the user credentials, but also synchronize the data, okay, related to companies, for example, okay? So I want that when I create a new company on the client side, this is automatically stored at the next access into the remote database, and vice versa. So if I have a remote company into the database, I want to see this company into the client side of the mobile app. Okay? Let's see how to do it. So the easiest way to reproduce the same class structure for the company on the client side and on the backend side, on the server side, is to copy the entity, okay, from the mobile project to the data service project, okay, so that I have the same attributes here and there, okay. Now I have to synchronize this new class, so I have to move it also to the database level, executing all of the SQL statements. Okay, and you will see that now if I browse the database directly from MySQL, I have also the company table. Okay, now how is made the synchronization process? The synchronization process is based on the timestamps on which the objects are created, okay? Created and, of course, updated, okay? So, basing on this timestamp information, the synchronization algorithm is able to understand if that value must be added to the client-side storage or vice versa. It must be written into the database, okay? And the communication between client side and server side is made in the same way, or more or less in the same way, that we already seen for the user services. Here we configured all of the available possibilities for the user, okay, which were register, login, and update. For the classes, for all of the other classes, you have to configure the data services, okay? So, for example, for the company class, I want to read, create, update, and delete both client and remote objects, okay? So I select everything, I put the OK, I press the OK button, and now you can see that the authenticated user of the mobile app can read, create, update, and delete companies. Okay? What are the results of these settings, of this configuration? The first result is that you see the created app and updated app timestamp attributes here that must be synchronized to the database. So you have to run once again the synchronization from the domain model to the database, export everything, okay, and when the synchronization is completed, you will see that the structure of the company table on the database is different. And now it includes the create and update timestamps, okay? Good. If I want to see remote companies on the mobile app, I have to create data, okay? Of course, I do not know the logo. I will put just the main informations, okay? So I create a company here, okay, and I put, this is mandatory, a create date, okay? Then I press the apply button so that I have a company which was created into the remote database on the 1st January of 2001, okay? So it must be synchronized to the client side, okay? Now, from what regards the data service project is everything. So I've created the same class that I have also in the mobile project. I exposed the services to read, create, update, and delete. I mapped the two timestamp attributes, okay? And now, from the mobile project, I have to synchronize the remote domain model, okay? You see that now it shows as incoming changes a new class which is called company 2, okay? Why you see this? You see this because we already have one company into the domain model, one company class into the domain model, okay? So the synchronization wants to create another class, okay, which is exactly the same of this one, okay? You see, it's exactly the same. So what we can do to avoid of having two similar classes? You select the company class from the domain model, okay? You move to the properties view, into the mapping tab, okay? And from here, you can choose the remote project, which is the remote data service project that it's already defined, is company manager backend. And you can choose the server class that you want to use, which is the company class, okay? So you pick the remote company class, you click on OK, you see that remote OID created that and updated that are added. You have to remember that you have to map all of the other attributes of the entity, and you have to do it manually. The OID must not be mapped with the remote one, but the name does, okay? So you have to choose the remote attribute for the name attribute, which is, of course, name, okay? So you repeat this procedure for all of the attributes that we already have. Okay. Remote ID created that and updated that are automatically mapped to be more accurate. Created that and updated that do not require the remote mapping. Okay? At this point, we can save and generate the mobile app. Okay? Once the generation process is completed, we will be able to log in into the application and synchronize the remote data, which is this WebRatio company that was added on the 1st of January 2001. Okay? Okay. Let me just log in here. It was admin. Well, this is a problem related to data synchronization. Let's see what's happening here. Okay, let me regenerate to be sure also the backend application. Maybe I forgot to generate previously, so I generate the new changes, and once the Tomcat is running, I also generate once again the mobile app. Okay, so now we have user services, which were the ones defined previously, but we also have company services. Okay, perfect. So let me close the emulator and let me run once again the mobile app. Okay. Okay, I open the Ripple emulator. You see synchronizing data. Since I was already logged in previously, he reminds the user credentials into the session data. So you see that I'm inside the mobile application with the new company WebRatio added on the backend. Okay? Let's suppose that another company is added to the remote database. Okay? The synchronization is not immediate, okay? What you have to do is to close the app and run the app once again, okay? Because it needs to run once again the synchronization. Synchronization is done when the user logs into the mobile application, okay? From the Ripple emulator, you will see the message synchronizing data while the application is loading. Okay, so and in the next access we will be able to see the new company into the list. Let's see what happens if we add a new company in the client side. Okay, so I create a new company here. Okay. I don't know, Milan, Italy. That it's a partner, I save. Operation is completed. If I go back to the home screen, I will see the new company here, okay? But I will not be able to see it immediately on the database for the same reason that I told you previously. Okay, so what I have to do here, I have to close the application and restart it once again. Okay, if this is not working, okay, on the back end we have the yellow software company added. Okay, but we don't have the Acer company, maybe because the synchronization was done after the previous one. So let's put a data which is older than the WebRatio company. Okay, well, it doesn't work in reading, but anyway, you have seen that writing a new company here it creates a new line into the remote database. Okay, so if I save from here and I go back to the list, I have the list of companies, and after the next reload of the application, I will be able to see it also on the back end of the database. Okay? Now, for data synchronization is everything. I just want to show you finally how to add the navigation between the screens, okay, with back and home buttons. Okay, so basically from each screen of our mobile project, you are able to model, or better, you are able to place the back and home events from the layout view. We will use a concept which is the toolbar concept. Okay, the toolbar helps you to create common buttons for a set of screens. Okay, if you define a toolbar inside a screen set, it means that all of the screens inside this screen set will inherit the same toolbar. Okay, in this app toolbar, I put the home event and the back event into the top bar of the layout view. Okay, in this way, each page will have the home button and back button on the top of the screen. Okay, let me just change the layout. I use a better layout, which is the button bar template for this toolbar. And if I generate once again, you will be able to see, after the synchronization, that there are the home and back buttons. Okay, so if I go to the details of Blue software, now I do not longer need to use the back button of the browser, but I can use directly the back button of the application. Okay, so I take a look at the details of WebRatio. If I want to go back to the home, I can click here. Okay, and the same for all the other screens that I have in my app. Okay, good. You see that now it has done the synchronization also for Blue software. Okay, perfect. So from a modeling point of view, this is everything that I wanted to show you into the live demo. I just want to finish, I just want to show you as one last thing, how to build a mobile project into a mobile app. Okay, so from the build command that you have into the toolbar, let's create, for example, an Android build if you want to test directly on your device. With Android, for example, you can just use the USB connection, okay, to run and install an application into the phone. So basically, I just create a new Android build configuration, okay, related to the Companies Manager app. The build mode is debug. I have to create a keystore file, okay. So I use an empty one that I prepared on my desktop. I put a password here. I have to confirm the password. I have to sign all of the certificate and Alice. I click the create button and it creates the keystore file with all the details. Okay. Then I can just click the apply button and run the build. Okay, the build process starts and creates the build directly on the cloud. Okay, on WebRatio cloud. So in a few seconds, you will be able to see the APK package ready to install the application on your device. Related to the build, we published it recently. Related to the build process and the store submission process, we published it on our learn .webratio.com website, two articles, which are how to build and publish an application on Google Play Store and on Apple Store, which shows you a step-by-step guide of all the required steps to create a build and publish your application to the store. Okay? This is for Android and iOS. Okay, so the build is still running, so let's wait a few seconds. Okay, now we are at the 50%. It's actually taking a little bit more. I think it's due to connection problems. So let's wait a little more time. Once the build process is completed, we will be able to download on our drive, okay, the APK package for the Companies Manager app, okay? So now it's at the 80%. Let's give time to the process. You can also monitor the build process from the console log, which logs all events related to the building process. Okay, now the build is completed. And from the app dashboard that we opened previously, you now see this new link, which is download app package, okay, or this QR code. The QR code downloads the app directly into your phone. I don't have a phone to show you, so I just download on my drive, okay. You see that here on Google Chrome, it starts downloading the APK file. You see here on the bottom left, and then you have the file downloaded into your drive. Okay. Okay, so you can see it here on my desktop. Okay? Companies Manager app 001 minus debug, which is the build mode that we choose, and then .apk. Perfect. So this is everything related to the live demo. Let's go back to the slide in order to close this lesson. I just wanted to remind you the mobile roadmaps for WebRatio mobile platform. So today basically the beta period starts, while the 9th of February it will start the mobile general availability, okay? The next steps, starting from tomorrow, you will receive from support@webratio.com an email with the instruction to install and run the mobile WebRatio mobile platform and the license configuration. You will have automatic updates almost every day because it's in beta, our our WebRatio platform is in beta. So basically you will have a lot of new feature and bug fixing. And of course feedbacks are welcome. So please write your feedback if you found something strange or something that you want to report to support@webratio.com. And remember that due to the release nature, we do not guarantee any kind of stability and support before the general availability. Okay? The mobile beta licenses, remember, will expire on the 10th of February, since, as I told previously, the 9th of February, the general availability, it will start. Okay, so this is everything for this webinar. Now I'm happy to collect your questions and answer your questions. There was a question previously asking where you can download this version of WebRatio, but the links will arrive tomorrow, as I said previously. So tomorrow you will receive from our support team an email with instruction and license configuration. I'm waiting for other questions. I give you 10 minutes, okay, so let's wait 10 minutes if there are any questions. For the moment, thank you for joining and thank you for attending this webinar. If there are any questions, just write into the GoToMeeting chat and I will answer. Thank you once again. Okay, I see no question coming. So thank you once again for joining this webinar. And goodbye.